The Great Revolt, as the first Roman-Jewish war came to be known, was the first of three major conflicts between the Jewish people and Imperial Rome. After the Romans destroyed Jerusalem in 70 CE, they razed the temple to the ground, expelled the Jews from Jerusalem, forbade Bible study and ritual circumcision, and even changed the name of the country in an attempt to destroy its Jewish identity. But the creativity and courage of Israel's scribes and warriors ensured that Judaism would thrive and that hope would not die. Outstanding leaders such as Rabbi Yochanan ben Zakkai, Rabbi Akiva, and Shimon bar Kosiba, known as Bar Kokhba, not only guided the people throughout that challenging time, they continue to serve as role models for Jews throughout the millennia and have forever changed the way Jews think about themselves. Jewish sovereignty in Judea, the southern part of Israel, existed uninterruptedly after the Hasmoneans overcame a mighty Greek enemy 100 years earlier. But the independence of the Jewish state had been steadily eroding during Roman rule over the region, and by the beginning of the 1st century CE, the Romans were exercising direct control over most of the affairs of Judean society. In the year 70 CE, after 5 years of brutal warfare between the Roman army and the Judean militia, the Roman army destroyed Jerusalem. And with it, the Holy Temple, the religious, legal, and social heart of the Jewish people. But the destruction of Jerusalem did not end the revolt against the Roman occupation. A group of Jews held out for 3 years on Masada, a fortress situated on a rock plateau in the Judean desert. According to the historian Josephus, when the Romans were finally able to overcome the last of the defenders, the Jews drew lots to determine which one would kill the others and then take his own life. The account of what happened was given support in the 20th century by the work of archaeologist Yigal Yadin, although the evidence is inconclusive and other explanations may be more plausible. To punish the Jews and prevent further resistance, the Romans dispersed them around Judea, forcing them to leave Jerusalem and live in mainly non-Jewish areas along the coast, such as Ashdod and Yavne. Yavne became home to an academy run by the great sage Rabbi Yochanan ben Zakkai. During the Great Revolt, Rabbi Yochanan ben Zakkai had argued for a peaceful approach. He was in Jerusalem at the time of the Roman siege, and he only survived by arranging an escape out of the city in a coffin, feigning death. This allowed him to meet the Roman commander Vespasian. Rabbi Yochanan correctly predicted that Vespasian would be named emperor and that the temple would be destroyed. This got him on Vespasian's good side, and according to the Talmudic account, he had a special request for the new emperor: to spare Yavne and its sages. Vespasian agreed not to destroy the academy at Yavne, which grew to become a new Sanhedrin, a body of respected and authoritative scholars who would fulfill most of the legislative and judicial functions of the now destroyed Supreme Court in Jerusalem. It was here that the rabbis kept Jewish scholarship alive, maintained the transmission of Jewish learning, values, and ethics, and adapted Judaism to a world without a temple. This allowed Jewish spiritual life to be preserved despite the loss of its core. From Yavne, great sages such as Rabban Gamliel II taught Jews in the diaspora and answered religious questions that were sent to them. It was at this time that the title rabbi, which means teacher, came into use. Yavne functioned as a center of Jewish life from about 70 to 135 CE. A main goal of the rabbis at Yavne was to end sectarianism while creating a tolerant society in which vigorous debate was encouraged. And in this, they were quite successful. The polarized sects that existed before the destruction of Jerusalem, the Pharisees, Sadducees, Essenes, and many smaller ones, are never mentioned afterward. In their place, we see individuals, authoritative scholars such as Hillel and Shammai, who argue with each other passionately and vigorously, but without resorting to personal attacks. Regardless of their disagreements, they have no objection to socializing with and even marrying into each other's families. In fact, we see that rabbinic literature routinely mentions minority opinions, the views of the people who lost the argument. These people are accepted so long as they honor the majority decision, and their rejected opinions are even treated with respect. Could today's politicians and religious leaders learn something from the rabbis of Yavne almost 2,000 years ago? The second Jewish war against Rome occurred in the year 115 CE. It was really a lower-level conflict waged in various places in the diaspora. Jews rebelled against Roman and Greek rule in places such as Egypt, Libya, Cyprus, and Mesopotamia. Their goal was to attain freedom to practice their religion. Only 17 years later, however, a much larger war broke out, again in Judea, again to break free of the Roman occupation, and again on a massive scale. Its leader was Shimon bar Kosiba, known as Bar Kokhba. Bar Kokhba was a dynamic military leader who inspired the confidence of both the masses and the sages. He quickly drove the Romans from Jerusalem and minted coins to mark the years of Jerusalem's liberation and Israel's redemption. We should note here that the tumultuous events of the first and second centuries of the Common Era produced a lot of desperation. People were looking for a leader who would bring about the redemption of the Jewish people and their restoration in Jerusalem. At the time of the Bar Kokhba revolt, some, including Rabbi Akiva, thought that Bar Kokhba himself would fulfill that role. The next king of Israel who would bring peace to the Jewish people by fighting necessary wars, rebuilding the temple, and teaching Torah to Israel and the nations. Unfortunately, as events bore out, this was not to be. The Roman response was fierce and devastating. The Emperor Hadrian sent 35,000 Roman soldiers to quell the uprising. According to the Roman historian Cassius Dio, approximately 580,000 Jews died in the fighting alone. Many more died of starvation and disease. Communities throughout Judea were annihilated. Bar Kokhba died in 135 CE in defense of the stronghold Beth Tor, also known as Betar, in the Jerusalem hills. According to Jewish tradition, that town fell on the ninth day of the Jewish month of Av, a date already infamous for the destruction of both the first and second temple in Jerusalem. As a punishment for this rebellion, Hadrian expelled almost all Jews from Judea. He closed Yavne's academy and turned Jerusalem into a heathen city, renaming it Aelia Capitolina. That name didn't stick, but another one did. Hadrian renamed the entire province of Judea, calling it Palestina, after the Philistines, an ancient non-Semitic people who likely traveled to Israel across the Mediterranean from their home in Greece. Since the Philistines were foreigners whom the Israelites had battled many hundreds of years earlier, that name was about as un-Jewish as it came. And that was the point. Hadrian's goal was clear. He wanted to eradicate all Jewish connection to the land. The Romans also banned core practices of the Jewish religion. Brit Milah, Jewish ritual circumcision, was outlawed, and teaching Torah was a crime punishable by death. After Bar Kokhba's defeat, Rabbi Akiva defied the ban. He insisted on teaching publicly because he knew from his own experience the value of learning for each individual Jew and for the preservation of the community as a whole. Rabbi Akiva grew up as an illiterate shepherd. He did not even know how to pronounce the letters of the alphabet until he was 40. Rabbi Akiva's wife Rachel encouraged him to get an education and sacrificed much along the way to help him. The Talmud relates that Rabbi Akiva was cautioned by another sage not to teach Torah in public. Rabbi Akiva responded with a famous analogy. A fox comes to a body of water and tries to convince the fish to come out and live with him on dry land. After all, every moment the fish remains in the water, he's in danger of the fisherman's net. But the fish was too clever for this argument. He told the fox, "If I remain in the water, I'm surely at risk. But if I leave the water, I cannot live." In rabbinic literature, water is frequently used as a metaphor for Torah. The fisherman represents the Roman. Teaching Torah might at times pose a danger to one's life, but living without Torah is a form of spiritual death that's even worse. Rabbi Akiva's commitment to teaching led to his arrest. He was tortured, the Romans flayed his flesh with iron combs, and killed while reciting the Shema, the central affirmation of a Jew's belief in the unity and sovereignty of the one true God. As he was dying, he explained, "Now I realize why it says in the Shema to love God with all of one's soul. That is, I should love him even though he's taking away my life." Ever since Rabbi Akiva's time, it's been customary for Jews to recite the Shema on their deathbed. The challenges faced by the Jewish nation in the aftermath of the Great Revolt can't be overestimated. On a theological level, Jews had lost what they saw as the spiritual center of the universe. The temple, with all of its sacred objects, the physical representation of God's protective spiritual presence, had been destroyed and looted. Even before the destruction of the temple, the Romans had forcibly imposed upon the Jews the worship of the Roman pagan gods, including worship of the emperor, who was regarded as a deity from the first century on. With the temple now gone, the very public display of the power of Rome and her gods carried with it the suggestion that Israel and her God were powerless. Economically, the destruction and confiscation of land deprived the nation of essential resources. Politically, Jews had lost the central institutions of statehood. And how can we even begin to calculate the human and social cost from the enslavement and massacre of perhaps a million people in the siege of Jerusalem? The Bar Kokhba revolt of 132 to 135 CE resulted in the annihilation of entire communities on a scale not seen again, perhaps, until the Holocaust of the 20th century. The pressures placed upon the Jewish people were so great as to be existential. But outstanding individuals, some religious leaders, others military figures, rose to the fore and ensured that Jews and Judaism would survive for many more generations. Bar Kokhba's desire to see Jewish self-determination would inspire Zionists in the 20th century, who sought to combat the image of Jews as powerless victims, a stereotype that had become entrenched during the lengthy exile and persecution of 2,000 years. Thank you for watching this video. If you like what we're doing here, make sure to subscribe and hit that notification bell so you'll know immediately when we release new videos.